On Tuesday, February 28th, the National Association of Counties hosted a Capitol Hill briefing on Medicaid and the role of counties in local health systems. The briefing was held in conjunction with NACo's legislative conference. NACo sponsored the briefing along with our affiliates, the National Association of County Behavioral Health and Developmental Disability Directors, the National Association of County and City Health Officials, and the National Association of County Health Facilities, all of whom were represented on the panel. The Honorable Tony Carter, Commissioner from Ramsey County, Minnesota, kicked off the briefing. Commissioner Carter is chair of NACo's Healthy Counties Initiative and is a member of NACo's Board of Directors. Next on the panel, we heard from Mr. Robert Sheehan, Chief Executive Officer of the Michigan Association of Community Mental Health Boards. Next, we heard from Dr. Georgia Heiss, Public Health Director for Three Rivers District Health Department in Kentucky, serving the counties of Carroll, Gallatin, Owen, and Pendleton. Last, we heard from Mr. Don Haney, Nursing Home Administrator for Berry County, Michigan's Thornapple Manor, a skilled nursing facility serving older adults in Berry County, Michigan. Let's now pick up with Dr. Heiss.
So public health, you may or may not know, it's what we do as a society collectively to allow for conditions for people to live a healthy life. It's how we define what is acceptable versus unacceptable. For example, in D.C., Laquandra Nesbitt, she's your health department director here in D.C., she's across the way, and she came from Kentucky. She came from Louisville, Kentucky to here to be the health department director. But it is her department that makes sure that when you go out to eat tonight, you won't get sick, because she's inspecting the restaurants and making sure that they are following all the guidelines that makes your food safe. We are also, and it differs in some different states of who controls what, but in Kentucky, we're also the sewage guardians, so we make sure that you're not going to get sick from some runoff of a neighbor or some unscrupulous company that is going to do something that's caused you to be unhealthy. So our range of services is huge, even though a lot of times we're only associated with being a safety net provider of clinical medical services. We do that, health departments do that to a smaller or greater degree depending on the need in their area. For example, I have a home health agency in my district, and it's because we're very rural, out in the middle of nowhere, and for-profit agencies are a long way away. They don't want to come to our community for a handful of patients. Therefore, we assume that role and do that job. And it allows us to be very close to the community. We're very close to the folks that live there, the folks that are elected, the folks that make the decisions. We are governed by a board. The board is made up from representatives from each of our counties. The judge. So we have a judge that runs each county, that's kind of the CEO of the county, I guess, not an attorney judge that sits on the bench. But they are representatives on our governing board, and they also elect from each of the boards in the county another representative. So we have eight people who are deciding how we will spend the funds at the health department. We meet at least quarterly, but usually more than that, because we have lots of things to talk about. Unfortunately, in particular now, it's heroin. Also, we have a pesky hospital who's trying to take some of our property. There's a board meeting going on, even though I'm here and not at home, in Carrollton, Kentucky. We're having a little bit of a tug of war over some property and expansion of some buildings. But CAECO, which is our Kentucky affiliate of NACo, very good partner also, in that they allow for a funding source for our health departments. They also will provide loans, low interest loans, to health departments. We're very happy about that. I have a big note with them right now for my district office building. They also carry our lines of insurance. So whether it is insurance on the building or our insurance liability for our providers, so we have a really good partnership. They come to our conferences. We go to their conferences, just like here on the national level. But the especially in very rural areas, it is so important that we all work together and that we understand each other's mission, because as the commissioner was alluding to earlier, the determinants of health are more social than they are anything else, and we have to pool our resources to make things happen in the rural communities. Now, well, it's not just the rural communities, but especially in the rural communities, because our resources are small. So our county government is really, really important to us in making our operation work, and our operation keeps people healthy, and we do a lot of surveillance to try to keep things at bay before they get out of hand, and our main goal is to prevent things before they actually happen. So we're very happy to have a good relationship with the Association of Counties and hope for that to continue. Thank you. Thank you.
So thank you very much, Dr. Heise, for that overview of the work that you do in public health and particularly in rural communities. Now, last but not least, we will hear from Mr. Don Haney, Nursing Home Administrator for Berry County, Michigan's Thornapple Manor. Mr. Haney has more than 25 years of healthcare experience and more than 10 years of management experience in the long-term care skilled nursing industry. He was the chief financial officer of Pilgrim Manor, a continuing care retirement community in Grand Rapids, before joining Thornapple Manor in 2006. Mr. Haney is also heavily involved in his local community. He is serving on the Thornapple Kellogg Board of Education and the Berry County Economic Development Alliance Board, and he is also a member of the Spectrum Health PINIC Finance Committee. Thank you very much, Mr. Haney.
Thank you, Commissioner Carter, and welcome, and thank you for inviting me to speak today. Tell you a little bit about medical care facilities, skilled nursing facilities in Michigan. The history of our facilities go back to the 1800s, and they're rooted in the old poor farms in the state. So we have historically been driven to take care of those that have been underserved in our history. Our skilled nursing facilities are state-of-the-art and provide services such as dementia care, long-term care for custodial care, as well as rehab care for those that need to come in and do some short-term rehab, whether from a hip replacement, knee replacement, or cardiac rehab, and then return home. Some of our facilities also have assisted living facilities, home health services agencies, providing respite care, adult day services, and are very innovative in the services that they're providing. Our skilled nursing facilities, county facilities in Michigan, are also very focused on quality. A couple examples. Zero M's county medical care skilled nursing facilities in Michigan are one or two stars with respect to staffing. Simply put, we staff better than our peers do. 89% of our facilities are four or five stars for staffing. 75% of our facilities are four or five stars overall. Almost 60% of our facilities are four or five stars with our quality measures. Compare that with our peers in the state. 22% of the facilities in the state are five-star. Of our county skilled nursing facilities, 46% are five-star facilities. We provide innovative care and state-of-the-art facilities. Our facility, Thornapple Manor, has 96 private rooms. Our counterpart in the county is all semi-private rooms. It's brand new and fresh, and it's often referred to as an all-inclusive five-star resort by our residents and their families. The innovative care that we're providing, Ingham County Medical Care Facility has partnered with their local hospital and actually created a med-surg unit. So folks that have had surgery will be discharged from the surgery to the skilled nursing facility for their post-op rehab. They've also been part of an owner in a PACE program, as Calhoun County is also part of a PACE program in their county. Thornapple Manor, our facility, has also partnered with our local hospital to provide physician services. So the physicians that are taking care of the residents in the hospital also come out and follow them at our facility. One of the little things that we found in this process is the last thing that the hospital does when they discharge a patient is take a set of labs so they know where they were when they left. First thing that we did when we admitted a patient was take a set of labs so we know where they are when they got admitted. We no longer do that. The physicians have access to those lab results from their discharge at the hospital, so we just bring them in. It's less cost, and more importantly, it's less intrusive to the patient who's not getting poked twice for the same thing within 2 hours. Our facilities are also very focused on resident care and focused on the E alternative, which is putting our focus back to the residents and making sure we're putting them first and foremost in our decision making and giving them as much control over their lives as we can possibly give them. Lastly, we actually are a low-cost provider. For the right resident at the right time, we can provide services at $400 a day, $300 to $400 a day, versus a hospital at $3,000 to $4,000 a day. So when they're being admitted to the ER, some insurance plans are actually directing them to be admitted out to a skilled nursing facility instead of into the hospital because we can do the same thing at a much better rate. In summary, skilled nursing facilities and county skilled nursing facilities in the state of Michigan act, and across the country, act as a great safety net for the residents of our counties.
Thank you. So thank you very much, Mr. Haney. You've heard from our panelists who've come to share with you information to provide a foundation about counties' roles in health. And now we'd like to hear from you. We are ready for your questions and hope to be able to share with you a great deal about the critical role of counties in health. Thank you. Thank you.
So let's go for like an hour and a half on those two topics.
We'll do the mental health parity first.
Let's do parity first. We're a long way from parity. The parity bills passed in Congress, and in most states, by the way, we're a long way from parity. I think on the surface, parity looks like it's being adhered to because the copays and deductibles are no higher than they are for physical health care. But everything else that would make you feel that your behavioral health care is on par from physical health is not on par. For example, the range of care that you can get in behavioral health care is nowhere near what it is for physical health care. Traditionally, most commercial plans provide outpatient psychotherapy, psychiatry, and inpatient care. Nothing else. No residential or drop-in or case management or what we call ACT teams. None of the stuff that we know, none of the evidence-based practices that we know work. So we're a long way from parity. I do think there are more initiatives nationwide to begin to enforce parity, and we're hopeful that will happen. I think it's going to take enforcement. Behavioral health care has a long way to go in terms of an equal playing field, and we have a long way to go with that. So, and we can stay around afterwards to talk in detail about some of the plans that are happening here. The second one was about mental health care for inmates in jail. You probably, as I said, 90% of all behavioral health care in the public side is paid for with Medicaid. Medicaid has a prohibition. You can't use Medicaid dollars in jail. Even if a person retains their Medicaid eligibility, it's suspended in most states. So they have it and they get it when it starts up again when they're released. It turns out that in Michigan, over half the people in county jails are there pre-adjudication, meaning they haven't been convicted of a crime yet. They just can't afford bail. So we're taking people with mental health needs who are in poverty and prohibiting them from using their Medicaid benefit, which was good the minute before they got arrested. So Michigan and other states across the country are working with the federal government to get a waiver, which what it would take, a waiver of Medicaid regulations to allow Medicaid to be used in county jails. Because otherwise, county jails have a price tag, which is quite hefty, and each county has to pay for that mental health care in the county jail. Most counties can't afford that. Psychotropic drugs, the drugs we use, are expensive, and the care is expensive. And so people go without care for 30, 60, 90 days, sometimes up to a year before they're adjudicated. And sometimes, you know, found innocent. So they were without their mental health care. So we have a long way to go, but that one's pretty obvious. Across both sides of the aisle, the R's and the D's both agree this is a problem. People with mental health needs or substance use disorders who are in jail, especially pre-adjudication, should not be denied that care.
Thank you. The other thing I might add is that this certainly has an impact on people who need mental health care, who need all kinds of care. It has an impact on county budgets, very much so as well, physical care included. And as we describe the fact that uncompensated care can be unexpected, imagine what can happen in a jail or in a correctional facility if there's an outbreak of pneumonia, for example, and the millions of dollars that it might cost to treat individuals who are in our facilities. That becomes a burden on county taxpayers. I am sharing this with you because I am a witness in my county from that type of outbreak. Certainly, we need to look at the inmate exclusion and relief or restructuring of that exclusion, because counties do suffer when things of this sort happen, and it's a burden on all of us and our taxpayers. A next question? Yes, thank you.
Because more and more people are getting health insurance, we're able to cover the costs. But we still have gaps because the state of Idaho is not expanding Medicaid. Not likely in the near future. We pushed really hard. We got really close last year, and of course the Freedom Whatever Foundation thing jumped in and screwed things up, frankly. When somebody gets hurt, or when somebody gets sick in Idaho, they come to the commissioners, we pay for qualified indigents, we pay the first $11,000. The rest of that goes to the state of Idaho and CAPS fund. Last week, we funded a $45,000 bill because somebody got appendicitis before their business health insurance kicked in, which was a month later. We need people to be insured. We have to keep, I'm terrified of all of this conversation that's going on right now in this city to take away people's health insurance. We can't have that happen. We can't afford it. At the county level, it's gonna destroy us. I mean, if we only look at the finances, it's gonna be horrible for property taxpayers around this country, at least in Idaho. We can't give up insurance. We need more people to be insured, not fewer people to be insured. And I'm not satisfied with what they're proposing in this building over here. I think I'm pointing in the right direction. And the other one up the street, it's not going to work. We need to protect this. And we need to get together as county officials and support this and make sure that we're losing that. I'm also the vice chair of our regional behavioral health board. I can't even get to that conversation because the basic foundation of what we need is health insurance. And then we can start addressing behavioral health. I mean, we're trying to do both, but I mean, it's ridiculous to keep taking our pills. But I mean, we're doing well now, but we're doing better. But it's with the conversations we're having, I'm just really terrified.
Well, certainly, and that is why we're here. I appreciate your voice and the fact that you're raising it at this point. We all want to do the same. We have been able to provide insurance through the expansion to many people. Don't know the number nationally. What is that number? Okay, about 10 million nationally. And so we have concern for those and for others who need health insurance across all of our communities. It's at the foundation of our ability to have safe communities. Our health, all of our health, is impacted by the ability for all to be healthy, not to mention our economic progress as well. Did you want to comment on that, Dr. Hines?
I can speak to that a little bit. In Kentucky, we rolled out in the national eye with our expanded Medicaid, even though we were one of the last states to do that. And then we had our own health benefits exchange temporarily. One thing that we have missed with all of this is the education. when you give insurance to a person who has never had it, if you don't give them the tools to understand what to do with that new insurance, a lot of times it does not get utilized. So even though we've made great strides, we could do even better. We could do even better. The folks that now have insurance hopefully can keep it. Education provided, I think, by the health departments could definitely make the numbers even better of what we've accomplished so far. So Affordable Care Act has done some great things for the health departments in that people with insurance were able to have a medical home, meaning they had a primary care provider and wraparound services versus just being able to go to the emergency room or to the health department to get a service at the last minute because they couldn't get it anywhere else. So the availability of more than one service, the thought of how to take care of your health, not just when something's broken, how to fix it, has been wonderful.
Thank you.
Miriam Morrison, Douglas County, Nebraska. And all of this is important. And what I'm concerned about is not only the parity issues, but the Medicaid expansion issue or not expansion issue is our aging population. And I'm sure you see in your nursing homes that there's an increase in depression and anxiety with our older populations. And that is just going to get worse, in my opinion. So we not only have the young, the current, we're also seeing the aging population running into a lot of the same problems.
Do you want to speak to that, Mr. Haney?
Yes, you're absolutely right. We're starting to see bigger and bigger issues around mental health issues within our long-term care environment. And, you know, we try to treat first with behavior issues, with behavioral changes, with non-pharmacological interventions. So we try to do that first, but it's becoming a bigger and bigger problem, and it's getting larger and larger, and it's requiring more and more of our social work time. I've gone from 1.5 social workers to 3.5 just because of the behavioral issues that we're dealing with.
Thank you. I saw another. Thank you.
Washington. We too are a rural county under 30,000 population, a single health care provider that is over an hour and a half away from some of our residents. We also are the second oldest county in the United States. But in spite of that, I want to speak to the other population, which is our young people. We happen to have one of the lowest vaccination rates. That's not a good statistic. That our kids are not getting vaccinated, and that our public health department is the primary place for vaccinations. Last year we had a death from measles. This year we have a mumps outbreak. These diseases that
we thought we'd conquered,
we're not seeing, are reappearing, and there are going to be long-term consequences for our communities, and it's going to be costly. So whatever we can do to support public health, our departments, and again, vaccinations, protect our kids so that we can live to be old and in one of your nice homes.
Thank you for underscoring that point. Did anyone want to speak to that? If not, I see another question here. Dr. Heiss.
Okay. Well, the problem, first, thank you to the lady that said go immunizations, because that is so easy. That is such an easy fix to prevent it before it ever happens. And unfortunately, the health departments are not sexy, so when somebody gets on TV and starts talking about the dangers of immunizations, or it has this or that in it and it's going to cause this problem with the your child or whatever, it gets a lot more attention than us saying, please don't let these diseases that we eradicated come back. Okay, so with that said, a block grant. In terms of how the health departments are funded, block grants are wonderful because they allow us to, at the local level, determine where our needs are based on needs assessment and then apply it that way. That being said, they are easily labeled a slush fund and can be taken away with the stroke of a pen, and that's normally what happens. So even though the concept, I like the concept, it would work well, but the reality is if there's not something attached to it that can be measured readily, they're very easily lost.
Thank you. Turn to Dr. Shin. I'm sorry, Mr. Shin.
You can call me doctor.
Okay.
We should be clear that the goal of the federal Medicaid block grant is to reduce federal expenditures of Medicaid. Let's just be clear, right? I mean, we can call all kinds of things, but that's what it is. In fact, if you look at the plan in the next 10 years, if the block grant went through, as some of the plans call for, it's a 30% reduction in Medicaid. You know, I mean, I tell people the problem in America is we have too much health care to people, really. Really, that's the problem? I don't think so. That's not the problem. So let's not solve it with a dramatic reduction in federal support for mental health and physical health and long-term care. That's not the problem. I think block grants actually just exacerbate a problem. Those of you, you talked about if you're in a non-Medicaid expansion state, you know what it feels like across the border for states who actually expanded Medicaid. The lives of people with Medicaid coverage who have never had it have changed dramatically. Long-term care, physical health care, behavioral health care. And to take that now in the middle of this, I think it's a mistake. There's lots of improvements to make to the ACA. In fact, the biggest improvement is to close the cost gap of deductibles so people don't get a subsidy, which is actually a greater federal and state cost, not a reduction. So I think we should be clear and not let policy proposals be masked as something other than cost savings.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I'll probably get fired for saying all of
that. Thank you. Is it right here? Thank you.
From California. Barbara, I just wanted to ask you to, and anybody on the panel, to talk about the impact of the repeal of the ACA on our ability to address particularly the opioid disaster and issue that we have right now, because I know that with Medicaid expansion, or prior to Medicaid expansion, a lot of people who weren't being served with their substance use problems were single childless adults. So the ACA expansion gave us the opportunity for the first time to expand and start building a substance use system. And it's just getting started at a time when we're talking about taking the work. So can you comment on that?
Thank you. We'll start with Dr. Hess.
Okay. Well, let me speak again to the block grant. So I understand the expanded Medicaid, and expanded Medicaid was a great thing in Kentucky, and we still have it, even though there was a fear it might go away. The block grant part of Medicaid is not funding for the health department, which is different than for health care providers. We're funded a different way. So for me, a block grant would be awesome, except when somebody decided I didn't need it anymore and took it away. That's not the same if you are the gentleman to each my sides. The way they're funded through Medicaid is different, which is one reason that we have such trouble with healthcare. It's so complicated, nobody can figure it out. And it's easy to turn somebody's focus from what they should really be looking at to something else, and then before you know it, the money is gone. Now, to opioids, unfortunately, there's not a good cure for that. Nobody knows how we can fix that, and we cannot, we can't legislate our way out of it, we can't treat our way out of it, we can't arrest our way out of it. It has to do with why people seek this to start with, and I think it is adverse childhood experiences in terms of why do people reach for these drugs to start with, and it's not the same for everybody. In some instances, it's because somebody was given a prescription and it did not work out well for them. In some instances, it's because they had no way out and there was a adverse childhood experience in terms of how they grew up and what their family life was like or it wasn't like. Those are very complicated issues that are not fixed by rehab. They're not fixed by treatment. Even though we have to have those things, that's all we have. That's all we can apply at this time. We don't know anything else to do, but the answers are not easy.
If I could, Medicaid expansion states, and it was said well, from ages 18 to 64, those childless adults had no coverage. Some states were able to provide substance abuse treatment, but opiate treatment is expensive. Methadone, Suboxone is expensive, ongoing treatment. For the first time, with Medicaid expansion, at least in Michigan, we saw a robust benefit for opiate treatment and prevention, like we've never seen before. Real dollars brought to the table to stem real deaths. The opiate death rate is staggering nationwide. Small towns, large towns, suburbs, white folks, folks of color, the opiate addiction is death. And so I've been stunned with how good Medicaid expansion has done, almost overnight, providing tools in Michigan communities to fight the opiate addiction. The fear we have this, we just got the bandwagon going. This is our second year. And so all the tools we need would be eliminated if Medicaid expansion through the ACA repeal were to happen. And so we're concerned. I think the juxtaposition of those two things is a train wreck. You're talking about an opiate problem that needs treatment and prevention, and its major funding source to fight it could potentially be rolled up and put aside, and that's a concern.
So the bottom line is real access and increasing quality of care. Individuals who have previously been unable to access that care have been able to now through the Medicaid expansion. To tell the stories of our success. A couple of days ago, I was hearing about a similar kind of improvement in the treatment of the HIV/AIDS and reduction in viral HIV/AIDS. And we haven't talked about that enough to realize that the reason it can be tied back to, in fact, the expansion in our ability to be able to treat people, single adults who previously could not have accessed that care. I thought I saw another question. Was there? All right, I'll go back to you. Thank you. Dr. Heiss.
Yes. I think that would be wonderful. Have I seen examples? Not anything that was publicly funded. There are some foundations and some grants, one-time grants, at least in my area, that funded community health workers. We have a program called HANDS, and it's actually early childhood education. It starts when there's a positive pregnancy test, and it follows the parent through the pregnancy and up till the child is 2 years old, which I don't think is old enough. But if the person meets the criteria that they could use the services, then they have a community health worker who they interact with on a regular basis. They meet some milestones. They help the family understand what the child needs, when they need it, what services are available, and how to get them. And that has tremendous outcomes. We've been able to show lessened child abuse rates, higher immunization rates, less low birth weights. So we're having a lot of success with that. The funding is hard to come by. That's the kind of thing that we would love to see expanded Medicaid pay for. It would be very helpful. But at this moment, I see some good methods, but not funding for them.
Thank you. One more question, one or two, I think. Thank you, Jennifer.
Here with the Virginia we hear a lot of kind of trepidation about what's on the horizon and a lot of anxiety, pretty much everywhere we go, we're talking about the issues that are important to all of us in this room. And so I would ask, in the immortal words of Rufus and Shaka Khan, tell me something good. We see good on the horizon.
I should remember that one. And that is actually why we're here too. We don't know enough right now about what potentially could happen, about what is being framed. We need to share the need for our ability to create health and to increase health in our community. So we are concerned about a number of proposals that are being floated. I think the good news that we would be looking forward to hearing would be that those concerns can be abated, that Medicaid expansion will continue to be funded. You know, that in fact we will continue to have the ability to see pre-existing conditions funded. You know, that we won't be able, or that we won't have to face a block grant for Medicaid, which is individual access to health care and needs to be available for all. Certainly that a block grant won't turn then into a cap that could limit the amount expended for Medicaid, where conditions require health care beyond that limit. So we're looking for that good news and hoping that our voices here in the nation's capital today will help us to net that type of good news in an environment where things are currently in flux and we're not sure exactly where they'll land.
Before the election, the majority said they didn't like Obamacare, and now people realize they have it. And that's a good thing. The raising consciousness of Americans about the political side of this is stunning. That people realize that Obamacare, the ACA, actually covered more people than people realize. In fact, I heard a study before the election that half the electorate didn't know that the ACA broadened coverage for 20 to 30 million people. I mean, it was a stunning figure. I think secondly, people know who their congresspersons are. They didn't last week. So it's been a really big civics lesson, I think, for America. That's a good thing. I think people need to, I think, take political action when they think the welfare of their loved ones or themselves is harmed. And I think that's what we're seeing. So Jennifer, I think that's the upside, I think.
Thank you very much. I appreciate the participation that we've had today. Certainly the voices that have been lifted up that will help us to ensure that county's role in health is known. And secondly, I appreciate those who are here who are able to provide influence in the direction that these changes in healthcare may take. We need your help, and we are looking for you to tell us something good. So as Congress considers these changes, those that we have mentioned and others, we hope that we will be looking to the success of the program and the health of all our constituents. We want to make sure that any structural changes that are made to Medicaid do not have unintended consequences of shifting costs to local governments and to our taxpayers. And we're urging Congress to remember that a strong federal, state, local partnership is required in order to sustain healthy and prosperous communities. I want, lastly, to thank you all once again for being here. We'll leave you with one final thought. If you leave here today with nothing else, please remember that whatever happens here in D.C., all health is local. Our intergovernmental partners, and we're ready to be at the table with you. Together, we do believe that we can improve the health of our nation while also being fiscally responsible to our constituents. Once again, I want to thank you so very much for being here.